morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. John's. This is a place where
grace abounds.
And grace abounds for us as we have a God who clings to us so tightly that absolutely nothing can take us away from Him. That's the good news for us this morning. A couple announcements. I'll turn your attention to reflecting His light. A couple things coming up. Trunk or Treat will be here before we know it. That's Sunday before the Trunk or Treat happens, Sunday, October 30th. After the service, if you could plan on staying just for a little bit afterwards, we could use some help putting together some candy bags. We are still asking for candy. In the next couple of weeks, we'll be collecting those. You go to the store, candy's definitely out. If you want to just grab another bag and bring it to church, that'd be awesome. We could use all the candy that we could get. And alongside that, we're still asking for monetary donations for our big toxic meltdown event that's going to be happening in the parking lot at Trunk or Treat, on October 31st from 2 to 5. So all that's coming up, ladies. Fall fair, get that on your calendars. That's November 5th, Saturday from 10 to 3 downstairs. This week, Bible study is back. And not only are we back, we're back in person. All right, so we'll be meeting downstairs in the connecting room. That's called the connecting room. Where's my brain today? What room? What day is it? Connecting room downstairs. We'll be meeting Tuesday at 11 and Thursday at 7. If you would still wish to join via Zoom, we will have the Zoom option available. We'll be able to see, we'll be able to connect. The Zoom information is the same. Okay, so that is in the under the spiritual growth opportunities. If you've been joining us by Zoom, you won't need to have anything changed for that. We can still see you. We'll make that happen. So anyway, back in person this week. Again, the Holy Land experience with Pastor Schultz. Hi, if anyone's interested, please let me know. I've kind of got to give him a heads up. For our service today, our psalm is broken up throughout the service of the Word in a couple different places. Our prayers today, we'll be responding not only with "Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayer," but we will also have a hymn stanza accompanying each petition. Everything else you need to know, of course, is up on the screen or in your bulletin. May God bless us in our time together as He meets us to deliver His good gifts to us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank You for gathering us together as Your church here in this place. We thank You for the good gifts You have to give us. Fill us with Your grace, forgiveness, life, salvation, and may we leave in peace. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand for our opening hymn.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
O Lord, open my lips.
And
make haste, O God, to deliver me.
Lord, make haste to deliver me.
The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit.
A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise.
Because of the suffering and death of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Heavenly Father will not hold our sins against us, but offers forgiveness, life, and salvation to all who call on Him for mercy and grace. Let us then confess our sins to Him in confident faith. Gracious God, you have known us before we were born, and since coming to faith, we have known your amazing grace. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For Jesus' sake, turn us from selfish ways to walk in paths pleasing to you, to the glory of your holy name. In the mercy of Almighty God, He gave His Son to live as one of us and to die for us. As surely as Jesus was born with Moabite Ruth in His human family tree, as certainly as the Samaritan leper was saved through His faith, and as confidently as Paul assured Timothy of the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. Great are the works of the Lord. Full of splendor and majesty is His work. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. We worship you. Almighty God, you showed mercy by sending your Son to become one of us and to die for us. Grant us always to see our coming to faith in him as the beginning of our lives, lived in communion with you in time and to eternity. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the readings of God's Word.
Naomi, and the names of their two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephraimites and from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with two sons. These took Moabite wives, and the name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. They lived there for about 10 years, and both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law to return to the country of Moab, for she had heard in the fields of Moab that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she was with her two daughters-in-law. They went on the way to return to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go, return each of you to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband." And then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? I have yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands. Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and bear sons, would you therefore wait until they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, for it is exceedingly bitter for me to, for your sake, that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me." Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. And she said, "See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. May the Lord do so to me and all mortals also. If anything but death parts me from you." And when Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more. So the two of them went on until they came to Bethlehem. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered.
The Lord is gracious and merciful.
He provides food for those who fear him. He has shown his people the power of his works.
Our second reading is an epistle from 2 Timothy chapter 2. You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Share in suffering as good soldiers of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. It is hard-working farmer who ought to have the first share of the crops. Think over what I said, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The works of his hands are faithful and just. They are established forever and ever. He sent redemption to his people. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
All those who practice it have good understanding. His praise endures forever.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated for our hymn of the day.
Thank you.
dear friends in Christ, if you lean in and listen closely, you'll hear Jesus being whispered on every page of the Old Testament. The Old Testament points us to Jesus, and he is its key that unlocks its meaning, its purpose. Every story points us in some way to the greater story of the cross. The story of Ruth is no exception. Jesus is there, as he promises to be, and friends, he has good news for you this morning. I couldn't pass up the chance to preach on Ruth this morning because not too long ago, our weekly Bible studies went through Ruth. And we had to go through Ruth after going through the dark depths of depravity that is the end of Judges. We finished that long journey through Judges. We needed something a little bit more uplifting. We even called Ruth a more proper end to the book of Judges. It happens during that same time period. This morning we have the beginning of the book of Ruth as our Old Testament text. It's a setup for the rest of the story. And the rest of the story, of course, gets us to Ruth's marriage to Boaz. And through that marriage, the two have a son named Obed. And Obed is the father of a man named Jesse. Ooh, some people know this. And Jesse is the father of King David. So ultimately, the kind of broader picture of this story points us to Jesus through a way of lineage, right? Jesus is preserving the blood, or excuse me, God is preserving the bloodline through which Jesus will be born. He's keeping his promises. This morning, though, we're going to focus specifically on the text before us. Just a little recap, there was a woman named Naomi. And her husband, Elimelech, had two sons, Malon and Chilion. And those two sons, they took Moabite wives. They were in Moab because of a famine. They had to move from Bethlehem. They moved to Moab. Those two sons took Orpah and Ruth. And while they were in Moab, tragedy struck. Elimelech and his two sons died, leaving Naomi with her two daughters-in-law. And now you have to understand how bad this situation was for Naomi. First of all, she's in a foreign land. So she had no social net but her family. And her blood family is now deceased. She was a woman, okay? And in those days especially, that meant no financial security without her husband or her sons. And there were no grandchildren. And that's just the practical side of things. She's also grieving. Knowing that she doesn't have anything to offer her daughters-in-law, and out of love for them, she truly loves them, she released them from any commitment that they might think that they would have to stay with her. They, of course, loved her too. They wanted to stay with her, and she was releasing them, saying, no, your best bet is to leave me, go back home, and get married so that you can survive. Now, this is a very practical suggestion. She's telling them, go out of love so you can be taken care of, right? Orpah and Ruth would, in essence, then, if they would stay with Naomi, be giving up everything. The text lets us be present during this intimate, painful moment. Naomi's hurting, and she goes so far as to say that God's hand has gone out against her. There's weeping, there's loud wailing from these women who love each other and don't want to separate. But eventually Orpah, she kisses her mother-in-law goodbye, and she does what she was asked to do. We went through this in Bible study, but Orpah's not doing anything wrong here, right? She's going off, she's doing what her mother-in-law told her to do. She is doing a very practically good thing. But Ruth does something surprising. Ruth, the text tells us, clung to Naomi. Ruth chose to stay by Naomi's side, even though Naomi had nothing to give her, nothing to offer. She knew that Naomi would not be able to give her another son to marry. So in that moment, right, Ruth is consigning herself to being a widow for the rest of her life. She's giving up everything. We know that's not how the story ends, but in this moment, she's consigning herself to being a widow. Ruth's decision, practically speaking, is not smart. It's not good, right? She, though, loves Naomi. She loves her mother-in-law, and she would rather give up her life for the good of someone else. There's nothing for her, practically speaking, but out of unconditional love for her mother-in-law, Ruth left behind everything. We might even say she died to everything so that she could be with Naomi until her dying day. Now, I know you're already starting to hear the whispers of Jesus in this story. If you lean in and listen, Jesus is there. Not by accident, there's a word in this text that serves as a bridge. When we're told that Ruth clung to Naomi, that word, here's your Hebrew word for the day, davak. Davak. She davak to Naomi. She holds her. The Hebrew reader would have their ears perk up at this moment. I've heard this word before. Davak, where have I heard this word? Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. The same word after God caused Adam to fall into a deep sleep while he took one of Adam's ribs and formed Eve, his wife. After he says, this is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. Genesis 2:24 says, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast, davak, to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. That word for hold fast, that's the same word. Davak, it's this word of being united to one another, to be bonded to someone, to be glued to them. I'm holding on and I'm not letting go. If you're wondering why there's flowers at the altar this morning, we had a wedding here yesterday. Mr. and Mrs. Markadakis, okay. They got married yesterday and they left the flowers there for us to enjoy this morning. I actually got to read that text at the wedding, right? The two shall become one flesh. Mr. and Mrs. Markadakis are clinging to each other now in matrimony. So that's the essence of Dubak. I remember this one time when Roman was younger. We were visiting my parents in Wisconsin, and we went to this thrift store, and it was around Halloween time, and at the entrance of this thrift store, there was this big mechanical monster with a pumpkin head, you know, the ones that kind of like move around. Terrified, right? So I held on to him, and Roman was clinging to my neck so that I could barely breathe. That's the Bach. Okay, I'm holding on for dear life and I'm not letting go. That's what a husband does to his wife. That's what Ruth did to her mother-in-law. And that's what Jesus does to you. So the Apostle Paul, in Ephesians chapter 5, he takes that same verse from Genesis. The same one that says, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and davak to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. He takes that verse and he says this about it in Ephesians 5:32. This mystery is profound. This one flesh union is profound. And I am saying, he says, that it refers to Christ and the church. Whoa, this one flesh union thing that we've been talking about, all of marriage, it all points us to Jesus and his marriage to his bride, who is the church, you and I. Yes, even the guys, we are the bride of Christ. This mystery is profound, and I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church, when Genesis speaks of this union of the two becoming one, it's talking about Jesus and us. Marriage is a picture of that greater reality of Jesus holding fast to us. And when the New Testament speaks about our baptism, it speaks in this language that unites us to Christ, okay? It never speaks symbolically about this. Baptism is never spoken of symbolically in this way, but by faith, through the water and the word, this is what God's word says. You are baptized into Christ. You are clothed with Christ. You have put on Christ. You are crucified with him. You are buried with him. You can probably guess the next one. You are raised with him. Your life is now hidden with Christ in God. This language is clear. When you are baptized, you're united to Jesus. It's like a marriage ceremony of sorts. What is Jesus doing in your baptism? He's clinging on to you. He's gluing himself to you. He is holding fast to his bride. He's dabaking you. Like the two becoming one flesh, Jesus is intimately and permanently joining you to himself. This bond is so tight. Jesus has such a tight grip on you that this is what St. Paul says in Romans chapter 8. You've heard these before. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we're being killed all the day long. We're regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. He says, no, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, starts off with the big ones, death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Our bond to Jesus by baptism is so strong. His grip on you is so tight that nothing, absolutely nothing, can take you away from him. So where Jesus is, you shall be also. What that means is you will never be abandoned, never be forsaken. You can't be rejected by the Father any more than he can reject his crucified and risen Son who now sits at his right hand. Your place in heaven is just as sure as Christ's place in heaven. You will be where he is because he has made you his own. In baptism, you've been connected to him, bonded to him forever. You also receive him in the supper. That's his promise to you. He will always be with you, no matter what. Even when it feels like he isn't. Now, we might not experience the same kind of suffering that Naomi experienced. But that doesn't mean that we won't suffer. We will, and we have been promised as much. And I know that you know this. There are times when we confess with Naomi that God's hand has gone out against us. Maybe like Naomi, the future life that you had hoped for has been dashed to pieces. Life hasn't gone the way that you have wanted it to go. Maybe like Naomi, you're in a financially tough situation with no social net, no provider. Maybe like Naomi, there is emptiness, barrenness, loss, grief. And Naomi was a believer. Naomi trusted in God. She trusted that he was going to send a savior. She had enough faith, she was confident enough to even say that God had dealt bitterly with her. And we can confess the same. But do you hear hope being whispered in this story? Do you hear Jesus being whispered in this text? We don't want to miss this. Ruth clung to her. In her deepest, darkest, most vulnerable moment of suffering, Naomi was not alone. Her selfless daughter-in-law gave up everything, even what her life could be, to be with her. For where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die and there will I be buried. May the Lord do so to me and more also if anything but death parts me from you. This is unconditional love. Love that gives up for another. She gave up herself for the better of another. So friends, when you are in your deepest, darkest, most vulnerable moments of suffering, you are not alone. Jesus clings to you. He holds fast to you like a husband does to his wife, like Ruth did to Naomi. He devours you and refuses to let go. Indeed, he cannot, for he cannot deny himself. He's already joined himself to you. Your life is hidden with his. He has already selflessly given of himself, even to death on a cross, because he loves you unconditionally and refuses to let anything separate you from him. So where you are, he will be also. May you, friends, be strengthened, assured, and confident in God's baptismal devok grip on you. No matter what you're going through, no matter what suffering you're enduring, no matter how bitter your situation, Jesus is there with you, loving you, holding you tight, and keeping you in him until he brings you home. Nothing, absolutely nothing can separate you from his love. Where you go, he will go. Where you lodge, he will lodge. He has made you his people. His father is your father. You've died with him and you've been buried with him. And nothing, not even death, will part you from him. For you will also rise with him. Thanks be to God. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand. Let us confess our faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. On the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The story of our lives has meaning only as God has entered it to give us faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Each day is lived under his grace. Let us pray for ourselves and all people, singing, Lord of all hopefulness, which looks at our life of faith in terms of a single day. Like Timothy, to proclaim your word confidently. Nurture them all with your word and sacraments, so that they grow in grace and knowledge of our Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Service. As Ruth accompanied Naomi to Bethlehem, so open the hearts of your people that they may become families of faith, sharing your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord of all kindliness, Lord of all grace,
we especially lift up to you today Jane Wicks, Chris Turner, Barbara Stanisic, Dick Verbowens, Eva Porte, Debbie Borchers, Ken Borchers, Carol Roach, Marilyn Stone, Charlie Stone, Kathy Kern, Marianne Meehan, Janine, Tom Bauman, Jeff Smith, Susan Henkel, Frank Giambrone, John Matern, and all those we name in our hearts. Strengthen them in their faith and hear their prayers for help, even as you heal the lepers. Be with first responders, emergency technicians, doctors and nurses, and all who use their gifts to relieve pain and restore health. Use us all with our various abilities to work for the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lord of all gentleness, Lord of all calm, whose voice is contentment, whose presence is calm, be there at our sleeping and give us, we pray, your peace in our hearts.
God, raise up leaders who seek peace across national borders and justice within them. Provide wisdom for trained counselors and direction for friends and neighbors, that they may calm the troubled hearts and ease strained nerves. Into your hands, we commend all for whom we pray for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And as we have peace with our Lord through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, we get to share that peace now with one another. Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who, having created all things, took on human flesh and was born in the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Amen. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. we open the cup. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. And now may this true body and this true blood strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the true faith, now unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. We continue with our distribution hymns.
Thank you.
Please stand. Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And as we receive the blessing of our Lord, we place our hands out in front of us like a cup. As a reminder that we come before God with nothing to give, nothing to offer, and everything to receive. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
And we continue with our closing hymn.
Thank you.
confidence of knowing that Jesus has a devok grip on you and he is never letting go. From the abounding grace of our Lord and God's blessings on your week. Amen.
Amen.